Hi, everyone. Good evening. I'm WITF's Director of Community Engagement, Heather Woolridge. Thank you so much for joining us for this special The Black Church screening. This virtual event is, of course, presented by WITF Public Media in Harrisburg. The power of faith and community and the remarkable history of the Black Church really showed through tonight as we watched selected clips from across the four-hour, two-part series. The film originally aired on WITF TV in February, and now we're pleased to be able to present this screening and panel discussion as a catalyst to share untold stories about the history of the Black Church here in central Pennsylvania, and to talk about how it continues to help shape our community today. We invite you, the audience, to also participate in this conversation. If you have a question or comment, you can go ahead and type it into the OV chat window, or you can also email us at discuss@witf.org. Right now, please join me in welcoming our moderator for tonight's discussion, Reverend Dr. Brenda Alton. She is the founder of Kingdom Embassy and System Manager of Spiritual Care Services for UPMC Pinnacle in Harrisburg. And also, special welcome to our panelists. Thanks for joining us. We have Senior Pastor Marlon Carter with Small Memorial AME Zion Church in York. He's also a member of the Black Ministers Association of York County. Welcome, Pastor Carter. And also welcome to Reverend Dr. Larry Pickens. He is the Executive Director of the Pennsylvania Council of Churches. Thank you all so much for joining us this evening. Right now, I'm gonna turn it over to Reverend Alton to go ahead and lead our panel discussion.
Thank you, Heather, and thank you, WITF, for this wonderful opportunity to talk about the Black Church, about faith, about social justice, about the impact of faith and religion upon the lives of the community that have sought for its identity in Christ and in its culture. I'm really blessed to be here with Pastor Carter and Reverend Pickens. And I want to lead this discussion off by asking first a general question. What is the role of the Black Church in your local community?
Well, let me say this. For me, the Black Church has always been the catalyst. It's been the place that advocated for the Black community. It's the place where people are really given an opportunity to gather, to find refuge from the experience of racism. And it's the place that gives voice to the hopes and the dreams of the Black community.
Amen. I like that. Pastor Carter, do you have any reflections on what
I agree, Dr. Pickens. It's a place where you know, I pastor the church in York County, Fallen Angel Zion Church, and that church just so happened to be 180 years old. Wow. But we found that place of refuge when we were driving deep out into the country. And the most amazing fact was when they purchased the church, it was four members. And they purchased the church 15 years prior to being free. So I stood on those shoulders, and you're absolutely right. And it gave me such a sense of pride to stand on those shoulders when they were able to purchase land and even have a church in the midst of slavery. And then to find that place of worship on Sunday morning was an amazing thing.
That's a tremendous history. And I know even at Kingdom Embassy, which was formerly known as Harambe United Church of Christ. And Harambe United Church of Christ was first known as St. John's UCC. And during the time in Harrisburg, it was in one of the most prominent white neighborhoods. And it was one of the prominent churches. And then the neighborhood began to change. But the church was not able to change with the neighborhood. And the attendance dwindled down to about five people. And they voted to close the church with hopes that they could revive it again that it would represent the neighborhood that was there. And if I were to describe our church then and now, it was a church in which Reverend Dr. Lewis T. Tate was the senior pastor. And he came with Black theology, and he came with being unapologetically Christian and unashamedly Black. And he really brought into the community this Afrocentric study and Black theology. And but there was always Christ in the center. Became very much a community engagement type of ministry. How do you feel that is, you know, we're talking about the transition that our church did, but what about the Black church and how it's changed in the past few decades? Do you believe it has changed, or do you believe it has the same roots and the same mission and goals?
You want to go, Reverend?
I think somewhere along the line, yes, it has the same mission and some of the same goals. But I think throughout the years, growing up in rural Mississippi and seeing those, the difference in the church, where everybody got dressed in a suit and tie to come to church, and now we're a little bit more relaxed when it comes down to worship. But we still, the same thing still stands. Jesus is still sovereign, and he still saved the lost. So we keep that tradition going. But yes, church has changed. Our genre of music has changed. Our different platforms have changed. So it's amazing. Yes, we have seen that change, but I still think that it drives us back to our original goal, and that's to still save the lost.
Mm-hmm. That's awesome.
Yes. Yeah, and I think that the foundation of the Black church is still there. I was thinking about that today when I reflected on the Derek Chauvin trial and the results of his being convicted, and I likened the Black experience with the children of Israel in exile when they asked the question, how can I sing the Lord's song in a foreign land? And I think that we're not in a foreign land, but we're in a land that was not created for us. And part of the dynamic of the Black church has really been a creative one of fashioning a reality for Black people. Mm-hmm. In a setting that oftentimes has been hostile, and I see that role being played out even today. I think one of the struggles that the Black church is experiencing is one that all of our churches are dealing with, and that is, how do we relate to young people? Mm-hmm. How do we relate to youth and young adults who are trying to find a sense of relevancy and oftentimes don't look to the church for it? So in some ways, that's a challenge for us and how we fashion a message to that generation.
Mm-hmm. Evidently, there was an influence of the church in your lives. Could you tell me a little bit about that influence, and possibly that influence is something that the church can look upon to invest in our youth?
Well, go ahead, Dr. Pickens.
You go. I'll follow you.
No, go ahead. Go ahead, Dr. I'll follow you.
I was going to say, well, what influenced me is that God is a God of second chances. And, you know, I grew up in a home that was not particularly religious. You know, we grew up as Baptists. And my experience early on was going to Sunday school and going to the candy store to spend the money that my parents gave me to put into the offering plate. But I think that for me, it came later when I had a sense of mission and a sense that God really had touched my life. I went to seminary, not really fully understanding what that would mean for me. but I felt a call to ministry. And when I look back on that call, there was a thread of people who were there encouraging me from my youth, you know, all the way to my adulthood, who really sort of served as signposts. And, you know, if I were to give you an image for what needs to happen for young people and for people in our community, it's that we have to be the signposts that lead them to a different kind of reality. And that's what happened for me.
Yeah, I love that. That is powerful. Reverend Carter?
Yeah. My influence was, I'm the son of a Baptist pastor. So we stayed in church every day, going to sweep the church, mopping church, attending service, Sunday school. So that was the influence. And I just couldn't wait to get out of the church. And during my tenure in the military, I served 25 years in the Navy. And by serving the 25 years in the Navy, I sort of found myself in that and realized the same thing, Dr. Pickens, that those same people were supporting me along the way and didn't realize and understand that I had that influence or being that example to others. And I realized that the biggest influence that we can have is we can just be a great example to those in the community. They're looking for somebody to show them something. And what they want to see is some genuine, real people who really love the Lord. And I think that's what we show them. And I think that was my biggest influence by looking at different people who really love the Lord and became that real catalyst for getting me started.
Yeah, I certainly agree with you. And, you know, we know that as those who follow the word, that love is the greatest thing. But for us to get there takes relationship. And I was noticing that one of our viewers was asking about ways that the best ways that predominantly white congregations can connect with predominantly Black churches in their area as friends and as allies for justice. And, you know, when we look back at the clip and when we think about where we have come from, it's really important first to understand the culture, to understand the history of a people, to, as Stephen Covey says, first seek to understand rather than to be understood. But relationship is key. And I know that there were several times there was places where, you know, the church has been the refuge, that as it was said in the screening, the church was the educator, the church was the political hub, the church was where finances happened and where meetings occurred for unity. And to perpetuate that again now is we have to get back to, I believe what you said, Reverend Carter, back to love and be authentic, be real, show those things. And yes, we used to have a banner in front of our church that said, celebrating our culture in Christ. So that whoever walked through that door, you don't have to assimilate, right? You come and you be who you are worshiping God. And if we are going to be the church as whole, not just the building, I believe that foundation is true love. And I believe that we need to not just talk about love, but we need to represent that love, and that the church should be that partner, that role in society of exemplifying love within the society that is so broken, that is needing hope. As our pastor preached last Sunday, hope has a name, and his name is Jesus. But when we allow, you know, different titles, denominations, problems to override who we are as the church, it gets cloudy. So as we think about that, what are your reflections regarding how do we come together? How can we walk together as brothers and sisters in Christ or allies in justice as the church?
Well, go ahead, Doc.
No, I will say this. In order for us to assimilate, I understand this, like exactly what you said, Dr. Alton. You have to understand me. And read the, we have to see the Bible from the same place. And I want you to understand that some of us in the Black church, we've been reading the Bible from a place of pain, a place of hurt, a place of joy, and a place of love. So in that same token, don't be afraid to preach truth to power and share that with us coming together and assimilating together. Just understand, we are coming from a different place. We want you to know that Black Lives Matter, and talk about our social justice, and talk about us a way forward, and talk about some of the injustices that we may face, voter suppression and things of that nature. So we want you to understand that, and it's just not a part of us just being here. It's a part of who we really are, and we're trusting God to move us forward in that same token. Go ahead, Dr. Pickens. Thank you.
Yeah, sure. You remember the movie Avatar.
Yes.
And there's this phrase in there, I see you.
Right.
I see you. Okay. And you cannot partner with anyone until you see them, until you experience their reality, until you understand their lives. And I think that's the key. We need to begin crossing the barriers, the borders that separate us, our communities, in order to discover that we have something in common. And we can't do that until we see the experience of others and come to understand them, and then begin to find ways to discover the intersectional ways in which the things that we're experiencing actually bring us together.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That's good, Doc.
It is. There's definitely a need for identity wherever we go. Right. We're living in a day and time where people are still trying to find out who they are. And our pain a lot of time has molded us in certain ways. And even our expression in music, they did a wonderful just a short snippet of the progress of Black music. And, you know, for me, I know there's a comment in the chat that talks about, you know, experiencing Black music, white music. I really think we need to use that we experience music, and those that are the composers, you know, just like the author of a book, but the composer of the music, the expression of our music, a lot of times comes from the deep emotion that we feel. But historically, we use songs to be able to give messages, like during the time with Harriet Tubman. Those songs weren't just songs because we were singing to be happy. They were messages given indicators of when to not travel, when to travel, where trouble was, where refuge was. And music has evolved in our churches. That, you know, there was a time where it was the Negro spirituals, then you had the time where it was the anthems, and then you had the times of the gospel music. And even when James Cleveland came out, you know, people were like, oh my, what is this? And then as they shared, you know, evolving more and more, what is the role in music in our churches from your vantage point, Reverend Carter?
Music to me, I'm a music aficionado, so I just love music. And one of those things is I feel that it's medicine to the soul. And music motivates, uplifts, it builds. And for some, Dr. Pickens, they've even said that some music helps the preacher preach on Sunday morning. But the music has evolved so much from as you mentioned, Dr. Alton, the singing Go Down Moses. And then we talk about how we overcome. So, but the music has went so far now to where it has to be a place, and Dr. Pickens mentioned this earlier, that we have to almost bring it to them in order for them to bring it to us, because some of our youngsters have never heard the words to Amazing Grace. They don't really understand how sweet that sound is. So they don't understand this little light of mine. So we have to engage them in that dialogue to let them know that hey, this was medicine to the soul. This moved us. And this is why some of us even went to church. I love going to choir rehearsal and singing on Sunday morning. I got a chance to get a stage, so I loved it. So singing and music has always been a staple in the Black church because it told the message to us.
Yes, it's truly a message. How about you, Dr.
Pinkett? And maybe Pastor Carter will come up with the hip hop version of Amazing Grace.
We're giving it a try, Doc.
Yeah, that speaks to that generation. You know, music is key. And, you know, for Black folks, I think music is critical in the worship experience. I think I peeped one of the questions that asked about Black music and white music. And, you know, I think for Black churches, music runs the gamut. I've been to some Black churches that can out Beethoven white folks. Mm-hmm. And I've been to some white churches that can really do the gospel thing. Yeah. So I don't think there's a one way of doing things in any of our traditions. And I think that's the beauty of who we are, our diversity. But I think that the music is critical to worship in all of our faith communities and finding ways, you know, music maybe is one of the most transcending ways or transformational things that we have in the life of our worship, because your music, you know, maybe even sometimes, Pastor, when we're not on our game with the sermon, the music can carry the worship experience. So I think it's critical when you think about our experience as Black folk and what that means for the worship experience even today.
Yes, and I agree that, you know, it's very key that even in the Psalms, how it's written about the importance of music and mm-hmm. how we incorporate it into the worship service. Many times in our funeral services, their homegoing services or celebration of life, and mm-hmm. that music at sometimes the hardest times, the most critical times in our life, can uplift. It brings such an uplifting of the spirit. Mm-hmm. But then I've also seen where a baby who can barely walk hears the beat of the music and begins to bob in the and move its little hands, and because there's, as you said, it's transcendent and it allows the soul to be ministered to, the spirit to mm-hmm. be ministered to, which then in my experiences opens up your ears to hear. You know, you lay aside all these other barriers and you just feel this freedom to be able to receive what the Spirit is saying. But I do believe that many, many of the churches now are becoming very diverse in their music. You know, they're singing hymns, and then some of them are, you know, revising them. There are the contemporary music, and you know, when I look at like Elevation Church or Casting Crowns, you know, there's music that's crossing over into Black churches as well as into white churches. And I believe it's because of what you said, that music has a power of its own. And if we can hear the message in the music, not just having music, but the message in the music, just like when the slaves were running away, there was a message and a meaning to the music that made the difference. So if we could pivot just a little bit, they mentioned in the screening about women in the church, and what has historically been the role of women in the churches that you have been involved in? Maybe even as a child, did you see women in ministry, or how did you see women in the church? Reverend Carter, would you start for us?
Growing up in the Baptist church, my father being a being a Baptist pastor, until the day he died, he just did not believe that there could be a woman to lead the church. And then as I got older and saw that the Lord calls whom he will, and I was just amazed how my father never wanted to bend on that. His lips were sealed about you sit in the back and you handle business. Now you can be my secretary, but you can't preach and you can't lead. It's unbelievable. You can be my cook, but you can't lead. So,
right.
So the thing about it is the injustice that women have faced in the church, I think it's kind of bad, because when you look at it, I love the role of Deborah and Esther. When you think about Deborah choosing Barak to go and handle the business, so when she was a judge, so it shows us then that even in the Old Testament that somebody was leading, and I wish that all of us. I'm so glad that in the Methodist Church, and you saw Miss Hood, 71 years old in the AME Zion Church, who came up. And I think that we were at the forefront of that. And I'm so grateful for it, because there are some powerful, just as yourself, Dr. Alts, there are some powerful women preachers out there who have to tell a story just as well as we can.
Oh, bless you. Thank you. Dr. Pickens.
You know, I think about this, and, you know, Harriet Tubman was a part of the AME Zion Church.
Yes,
and
sir.
So, you know, if there was ever an example of ministry and freeing people and lifting people, it was the model that she gave us.
Yes, sir.
So women, in my experience, have historically played a very significant role. When I first went into the ministry, there were women in my congregation who were a part of women's groups, you know, who would say to me, you know, come and participate in our study this summer, be a leader, you can do it, it's in you, you can. And these women just drew this out of me, encouraged me. And there have been women who have been really important in the life of the ministry. I'm a United Methodist in the life of our history. And they experienced sexism, and Black women experienced racism as well. But I think that their struggle speaks to the reality that there's a God who is able to take even our suffering and use that as fodder for helping us be the people we've been called to be. And I think that's something that we celebrate today. And I still don't think it's totally open for women in all of our churches, but I think that we see a better time. And I think part of the reality is that the human family can only be experienced in its fullness when all of us are working together and are able to use the gifts that God has given to us.
Yeah, that's a powerful statement. I believe God wants to use all of us and the totality of us as well.
Yes.
You know, so, you know, I don't have to try to act like a man when I preach. I just need to be all of who I am in the fullness of God. And I know for myself, growing up, I grew up in the Baptist church, and we never had any pastors until I got older. And then we had these three powerful women that Reverend Dr. Jones, he ordained. And when I received my call to ministry, he encouraged me to go to seminary. And it really was at seminary that I got to meet more women in ministry, because it was a lonely place at first. And I can tell you, there were some very mean, nasty letters that were sent because people did not believe that a woman should be, you know, a leader or a pastor. But things have evolved tremendously these days. And just like social and racial justice, equality, all these things are evolving and things are better, but it could be even greater, as you stated, Reverend Pickens. And so, you know, that leads me into when we look at the Black church and social justice. And we are specifically saying the Black church because this is what the theme is. This is what the history has been about. But how did the Black church support civil rights movement? And, you know, when we think about that, and even every time I look at the pictures of Dr. Martin Luther King walking with so many people, we not only see Black people, but we see Jewish, you know, we see gay, we see white, we see Asian. There are so many people walking with him. And then we also know that some of the churches did not support him, and they did not agree with his being forthright and standing up. But how did the Black church support the civil rights movement then?
Well, I don't think that there could have been a civil rights movement without the church.
I agree.
I think that when you say support, I think it was foundational. It was born out of the church. You know, when we look back at what happened to Emmett Till and his death and his lynching, and how that gave birth to the modern movement of civil rights in many ways in 1955, it sort of marks the impact that church leadership began to generate around the issues, you know, even in coalescing with Billie Holiday singing Strange Fruit.
Yes.
Ida B. Wells raising the issue around lynchings. You know, those are the kinds of things that began to coalesce. And the church was kind of the social gathering place where people could bring the experiences that they were grappling with in the Black community, and really served as a catalyst. So I don't think you can have a civil rights movement without the church. And I think the church really gave birth to really the substance of the movement.
Yeah, I agree with you, Dr. Carter.
I agree, Dr. Pickens. I can remember as a young man growing up in Mississippi, especially seeing the Fannie Lou Hamers, along with my father and a few more other prominent ministers in the Delta of Mississippi, and how they gelled together, just came and rallied around different social issues. And it all happened in the church. And I could, you know, going to those meetings in the church to hear Ms. Hamer and hear these prominent pastors in the area to encourage people to come out and vote. And it took that strong voice from some to motivate others and let everybody know that, hey, everything will be all right. So, yes, I definitely agree with you. And it congealed into what we now see as we had one of the poorest counties in the state. We saw a movement with affordable housing, more people getting out to vote. I mean, just to see that as a young man in Mississippi was amazing. So yeah, I agree with it. And it definitely started in the Black church. It was the epicenter for social justice back then. Mm-hmm.
Now, yeah. And I'm sorry. And Dr. Alton, you know, and conversely, when I think about the movement today,
yes,
I'm not so sure that it was born in the church.
Right.
And I'm not even sure it needs the church. Mm-hmm. So I think that's, you know, I just saw a question pop up about whether the church supports Black Lives Matter. In some ways, I think the church is playing catch up.
Yes.
So that's an important debate about what that means and how, what the role of the church will be in relation to what the movements are today.
Yes. I mean, personally, I have seen where I have belonged to like the Interdenominational Ministers Conference. I've been a part of the the regional network of pastors across the river, where so I was with, you know, predominantly Black institutions as well as white institutions. And I have seen over the years, like I'd say the past 15 to 18 years, the voice of the church becoming more silent and as not taking the lead as it did before. And is it, as you said, is it that they need us now, or have we just become so resolved? Or, you know, we are fighting to keep our churches open. I'm not sure what it is, but I know there are individuals within the churches that have positions in government that are, you know, on the front lines with Black Lives Matter. And I'll have to think about it a little bit while someone else speaks in regards to the Black church and social justice. But you have to know too, that there's a difference between the organization Black Lives Matter and the movement of Black Lives Matter. There's two separate agendas that are happening there. Anything that you have to say to that?
But Dr. Pickens, you're right. It starts a strong debate when we talk about, do they really need us now? But I don't think that the church can get can become reticent or get extremely taciturn at a time like this when it affects people in our community. And we just have to get to the point to where we'll say not today. And I've been conducting services in my parking lot. And I scream that throughout the community and let them know not today for anything. And even with the Black Ministers Association, we need to understand that we can't keep our mouths shut on an issue like this. That's even right. Though it appears that we're silent, but yet we're here and we're listening, and we also provide a voice, whether it's audible or whether it's just a head nod. But we are involved in the Black Lives Matter movement, and we're not taking a blind eye towards it because we realize that it affects some of the members of our congregation as well as our communities.
Absolutely. And I think that's one of the key points, is that those that are being affected are a part of our community, are a part of our congregations. And I'm not sure about you, but I've experienced in our church where the events of the day are mentioned in our church so that, you know, this time frame that we have of this, you know, captive audience, that they hear that, you know, it's time to vote, that they hear that it's time to get registered to vote, that they hear that there's an injustice and we need to pray or we need to march, or, you know, and it's a way of keeping people informed of the things that are important. Because I have a saying that I can't remember where I heard it, but if you are not at the table, you will be on the menu. And we need to be at the table as the church, but I think it definitely is looking much different. I mean, my prayer is, you know, Martin Luther King, we are so grateful for him and the movement, as well as all those that joined and walked with him. But we need the new we need this generation of Martins. We need this generation of Malcolm X's. We need this generation of Shirley Chisholm's. And, you know, we just need to be producing more and more of getting our youth and those that are young adults involved. And some of those things can take place when our churches hold events that they can learn, just like health fairs and career fairs and educational tours. The church can be very significant to that, especially if you have a church like we do in the part of the city where it's very poor, where the education system is not as strong. The church can be a gap filler and use its influence and its education and its wealth to be able to help the people that come and not only worship there to the music and hear the preacher, but to also help them to understand what is happening in our world and open up a safe space for them to discuss.
I agree, Dr. Altman, because I've asked the mayor to come to Small Memorial and to just conduct a town hall. Just hear your citizens of your city. Hear your citizens of your city. And when you hear those, when you hear the citizens of your city, they'll tell you exactly what we need in this area of town that we're in. And I stress to him, we have over 200 years of serving in York.
My goodness.
Small Memorial. So therefore, when we describe our church in the community, we talk about sustainment. So bring that same sustainment issues into our area and tell these people how they can help build something forward. Don't just look at it as being the downtrodden area of the community. Why don't we try to build something in this community to show the people that we can build them up and turn that situation around?
That's right. And connecting to other organizations. We don't have to do this alone, right? And so a question was asking, how do we help our youth? You know, as the church help our youth? Well, first of all, the church has needs to be that open vessel for them to feel welcome to come to. And, you know, as Dr. Founder, she said, you know, we can't be the place that just says no, no, no. We can be very sin conscious, but can we help people to be God conscious? Can we be love conscious? Can we be economic development conscious? If we have blighted buildings all around our neighborhood, our community development corporation, we need to find out how can we help the solution, because it's our neighborhood. And being able to start programs that will help our children if we know they're failing in reading. You know, the church is beyond just the Sunday morning worship service and a Wednesday night Bible study. It becomes the center of hope, a center of education, just like it was before, a center of economic change. But not everybody has that vision or that view. Any comments, Reverend Pickens?
Well, I think both of you have crystallized the issues that we confront. And I think that one, you know, I'm more and more aware that when we talk about young people, any of us, for example, is how much we struggle with the shame of our lives.
Yeah.
And so if someone is coming to the church and they have shame, the last thing they need is judgment.
Amen.
Amen.
That's like a ton of bricks coming down on them. So I think that, you know, one of the things I like about Life Church is that they have this symbol that's a cross, and it says cross equals in a heart, cross equals love. And I think that's powerful, because that's basically saying we're not here to judge you. We're here to love you.
Yes.
And that's really what the message of Jesus Christ was about, was loving humanity. And I think that's the message that we must embrace as faith communities.
Absolutely. Reverend Carter, you have any final thoughts that you'd like to share?
You know, my prayer is that we all, as we join in this discussion, that we will come together and use the slogan that Lowe's has, let's build something together and let's do something and make our church, not just our Black church, but all churches, a more viable entity within our cities and in our communities.
Yes. And, you know, when I think about the future of the church, I pray that we become the church that we talk about, that we preach about, that we would be the church of love, the church of hope, the church of refuge, a place where there's no judgment, just truth. And I'm believing that there are some people, and I'm looking at two of them, and you know the scripture says where two or three are gathered,
all right,
in the mix. So it only takes a couple. And if we can, as well as those that have been listening tonight, if we can keep the right mindset about the church, it's kingdom time. It's not church or religion time, it's kingdom time. Yeah. And we need to build the kingdom and show the light. Too much darkness in the world today. We need to show the light. So Thank you. And thank you, Heather. We give our thoughts back to you as we transition. Thank you, everyone, for joining tonight.
Thank you, Dr. Alton, for moderating.
No doubt. You're thank welcome. You, Dr. Alton. Fabulous job.
Thank you.
Yes, thank you so much to, for our wonderful moderator leading our conversation. That's Reverend Dr. Brenda Alton, founder of Kingdom Embassy and Assistant Manager of Spiritual Care Services for UPMC Pinnacle in Harrisburg. Thank you, Senior Pastor Marlon Carter with Small Memorial AME Zion Church in York, and Reverend Dr. Larry Pickens, Executive Director of the PA Council of Churches. Thank you so much for sharing your insight, your personal journey, your reflections on the film and about the church here in our community and the really important role that it plays now and will continue to play into the future. So thank you very much all for being here. We want to thank also to Hamilton Health Center and the PA Council of Churches, Pennsylvania Council of Churches, for supporting tonight's event, helping to make it possible. This evening was just a preview to watch the full documentary series, The Black Church. It did already previously air on WITF, as I mentioned earlier, back in February. Right now, it's currently available for full viewing through WITF Passport. Passport is available to current WITF members who support at a minimum of $60 a year, or that's $5 a month, and have to have an active email address on file with the station. But you can easily find out if you're eligible for Passport, because many of you, if you're a member, you might already be able to take advantage of that benefit. Or if you'd like to support WITF and receive access to WITF Passport, you can visit WITF.org/support. Coming up next Thursday, April the 29th at 7 p.m., you might want to mark your calendar and consider to join us for our next installment of WITF's virtual online conversation series, Toward Racial Justice. We'll explore current events affecting today's youth of color. During the discussion, we'll hear from Gen Z and millennials working to make a difference here in our communities and in the world. We'll discuss timely issues that are top of mind to young people of color today, ranging from juvenile justice, policing and safety, gun violence, education inequities, and more. You can register to attend at WITF.org/events. And you can also explore past Toward Racial Justice conversations at WITF.org/racial justice. Reverend Dr. Alton was actually one of our guests on one of our Toward Racial Justice conversations. And we were really honored that she was willing to come back and help moderate tonight's conversation. So once again, thank you to everyone who joined us tonight. Please stay safe and healthy. Goodbye and have a wonderful evening.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Was blind, but now I see.